You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good morning. Welcome to Health 395. It's a special topics course focusing on community health, or really how to promote health in your community. My name is Robin Sinks, and I'm the instructor for the course. And this is our second week of the semester. So I want to welcome all of you back, and I hope that today we might be able to really look a little bit about what health education is, how you might tailor health education messages to a specific audience, and then determine whether or not your audience, your learner, actually got the message that you were trying to get across. I do want to just do a very quick recap of what we did last week in course, and invite all of you to participate in today's discussion. Last week we talked a little bit about what this course is and about who health educators are. And so I want you to kind of think back to last week, and if you learned something new, you had an aha moment, a light bulb went off in your brain and didn't know that before, and you'd like to share that with us, you have an 800 number that you can call. I saw that flashed across the screen. You also have an email address that you can email me any of your thoughts. I think it's really important to reflect back on what we've done as we prepare for what we want to do today. I know for those of you who are taking this course for credit, you have had the opportunity to look at the syllabus. You've gotten some emails from me. We've had some great introductions via the discussion board. And you know what your expectations are in this class. I hope by now all of you have gotten your textbook. This is the textbook that we also use in a companion course, Health Education 300. But this will really give you, in addition to what we talk about here on the broadcast, some of the information you as a health educator, a health promoter, need to have, and some tips for working with your audience. This particular book focuses on elementary and middle school, but please know it is very appropriate for working with younger children as well as young adults, and some of the information that you might be able to use should you choose to work with an older population as well. If you have not taken Health 100 or 300, you do have the opportunity to catch up on some of those conversations by watching that Health 300 on YouTube. And so if you're feeling lost in here and want to make a connection back to that course, please feel free to do so. So, are you thinking about what we did last year, or last week? We talked about a code of ethics, and that we have some responsibilities to our public and to our profession and to our communities if, in fact, we are going to engage in this community health adventure. We did address some a little bit about learning theories and really how attitudes and social norms and perceived behavioral control influence an individual's intent to change a behavior and hopefully to become a little bit more healthy. And then we talked about a variety of brain-based strategies, how we get our brains involved in the learning so that it actually is meaningful, remembered, and can be applied. So hopefully now, as I've kind of reviewed some of that, your mind is waking up and saying, "Oh yes, I do remember that." Because what we want you, because what I want you to do is to consider those things as we talk a little bit today about how do we encourage our communities to be healthy. And again, when I use the term community and audience, a little bit of an interchange there. But you have to think about what community or what audience you want to have an impact on. That could be your family. It could be a classroom. It could be a neighborhood group, a church group. I think I've got several of the Cal State Dominguez Hills baseball players enrolled in the class. Maybe you want to have an influence on your teammates as well. So I want you to think about that question as we go through today's broadcast. How do we encourage our community to adopt healthy behaviors? Remember, as a health educator, we can't make anyone do anything, but we can be there to encourage and to motivate. I want you also to consider today the question, what do we need to consider when working with that audience? What are the variables that we have to think about as we plan our message? And then how do we know that they've gotten it? What are you going to do to make sure that they leave with the message that you intended, that they have acquired the skill you hoped that they would acquire? So those are the questions we'll consider today. And there's the 800 number, and I have a feeling the email address will come up. You can certainly have an exchange with me about your thoughts about that. What I would like to do is go over a little bit about what health education is, because I don't see a lot of health science majors on the enrollment roster. Just to touch what is health education and how do we do that? We implied a lot of it, I think, last week. Health education is really that type of instruction, whether it be formal or a less formal, that we do with individuals to provide them with the knowledge and the skills and the motivation to engage in healthier behaviors. And why do we do this? Why is health education so important? If you look at just six behaviors identified by the Centers for Disease Control that really impact the life of Americans, we are looking at tobacco use being the leading cause of death, disease, disability in today's society. We're looking at unhealthy dietary behaviors and physical inactivity contributing to the crisis we see around overweight and obesity. We know that alcohol and other drug use and abuse certainly impacts Americans. We see unintentional injuries taking their toll. Those are what we used to call accidents. And we see intentional injuries or violence having an impact on the quality of the lives of Americans. And then we also know that there are sexual behaviors that lead to sexually transmitted diseases, unintended pregnancies that impact our society. So those are some of the health issues that really impact life in America today and certainly provide a purpose for health education. We know that when we provide health education, not only can we change some health behaviors and improve health outcomes, but we also look at a lot of other behaviors. We look at a decrease in disruptive behaviors. We look at an increase in attentiveness, in participation, in concentration. Certainly, those are characteristics that are important whether you are in a classroom as a student, whether you're in a classroom as a teacher providing instruction, or if you're in a work situation. Those are all skills that we need to be able to look at. So what I'd like to do is to kind of start off with just a little bit of a health quiz. I want you to just sit there in the comfort of wherever you are and answer to yourselves, true or false, to the following five questions. First, it is healthy to wear a seatbelt. Is that true or is that false? Is it healthy to eat a nutritious breakfast? Is it healthy to brush and floss your teeth? Is it healthy to get 30 minutes of aerobic exercise at least every day? Is it healthy to get adequate sleep? Now, my guess is those of you who are with me this morning are saying those are all true. So let's go on to part B of our quiz. And this one you can answer again, yes or no, true or false. I always wear a seatbelt when I'm in a car. I always eat a nutritious breakfast every single day. I always brush and floss my teeth. I get 30 minutes of aerobic exercise every day. And I always get adequate sleep. Now, as you answered part B, did you answer as many in that section true or yes as you did in the first? My assumption is maybe not. And so what is the difference between part A and part B in that quiz? Well, it's behavior. It's the fact that knowledge and action are not the same. We can certainly know what we need to do for health. Our communities often know what they need to engage in, yet we don't actually get to that implementation, that action plan, that actual engaging in the behaviors. And that's what we as health educators can have an impact on. So certainly we hope that as we try to make an impact on our community or communities, we want to provide them with the knowledge and the skills, but also the motivation. Get them to a point where they actually feel confident that they can at least express an intent to engage in a healthy behavior. And hopefully then to take that next step where they actually are doing that. In education, in the K-12 system of education, there are what we call standards. We have standards for English language arts, we have standards for math, and we have standards for health education. What I'd like to do is to use that as a frame of reference for considering what knowledge and skills we need to know about and to be confident in using with our audience to get that message across. And it certainly is a balance between content and skills. If you envision going out and just giving information to change your community, it will fall short. If you only want to go out and do skill development, it will fall short. We need to do both of them in combination. So let's go through what is that content and what are those skills so we can kind of get off on all of the same foot. The first I want to talk about is health education core concepts. Some people call this essential concepts. At a national level, I think you're going to see it more referred to as core concepts. And really what that is, those core concepts, that is the functional knowledge that we need to have about health. And typically, we break that down in anywhere from 6 to 10 content areas. So when you think about core concepts, I want you to think about that light bulb going off in your head. Concepts being functional knowledge. And when we do that, we're actually looking at a variety of concepts. So if we go to that next slide, you're looking at what I've pulled out for 6 content areas. Those 6 content areas or health issues or the focus of health education are adapted from a national model of 10. First being personal and community health. What we do to take care of ourselves, the resources available in our community, what we need to know to be a good consumer of health. That's personal and community health. Going around a circle, we're going to hold on that slide just a minute. Let's back out of that one. Second is nutrition and physical activity. There's mental, emotional, and social health. There is injury prevention and safety. There is alcohol, tobacco, and other drug use. And there is growth, development, and sexual health. Those six health issues or content areas help us as health educators to decide what messages we might want to frame to our community. Now let's go to the slide that was just up and look at the health skills. Because there are several skills, and I think long ago we used to think that if we just gave people the information, they would get it. There's our content areas. Okay, here we go with our skills. We know that just giving folks information doesn't help. We know if we try to scare them into behaving in a healthy manner, it won't work. We really have to help them develop their skills. So let's take a look at each of these individually. The first we want to look at is analyzing health influences. All around us, we have influences that are impacting our thoughts about health behaviors. Some of those are internal, what we think about. Some of them are external, the media, friends, family, culture, peers. Those between the two impact what we do in our health. When you're going to the market to select something for dinner, you've got all of the visual images at the market. You've got your cultural perceptions about what's healthy and what's not. You have the money that's in your wallet. What can you afford for that night to put together something healthy? You've got your time. How quickly can I put together something healthy because I've got a lot of other things to balance? So certainly those influences matter, and we need to recognize those when we develop our message for our community. We also need to look at the skill of accessing valid health information. And how do we ensure that our community, our audience, knows how to get the accurate, valid health information they might need when you're not there? Remember we said that last week, we as health educators provide a lot of that information. Well, we're not with them all the time. So how can we teach them to evaluate a website or look at a pamphlet or a brochure or a commercial on television? What do we do to help them sort through all of that information? Those are two very important foundational skills that we need to pair with our health information. We also want to provide some type of support in interpersonal communication to our audience. When you're thinking about what you want to do with your community, your audience, not only how is your personal interpersonal communication impact their receiving the message, but how do you engage them in a dialogue? How do you help them to learn to communicate with other people in their circle of influence? If you're working with young children around eating healthier foods, how do you teach them to ask for healthier foods when they get home, or to refuse going to get too much fast food in a week? How do you teach them to negotiate? Well, if we did that today, let's do that tomorrow, so that they get that balance in health. Some of the other skills that you look at are the ability to make decisions. Our students need to learn how to make decisions. And looking at, what is the decision to be made? What am I going to eat tonight? And what are my alternatives? What are my choices? And then if I look at all of my choices, how do I make the best choice looking at then the consequences of each of those. So decision making is very much going to be a part of getting your community or your audience to go from their own beliefs into their own intentions into actual behavior. And goal setting. How do we work with our community to set healthier goals? I know we talk a lot in education about setting goals for education. What am I going to do to get into a career? What am I going to do to get into college? But we need to look at goal setting in a healthier type mode. What I'd like to do is just share with you a quick video clip how Michael Phelps, the Olympic swimmer, expresses how he sets and tracks his own goals. So if we could have that video clip.
Every year, probably once or twice a year, I write down the goals that I want to achieve that year and over the next 4 years. And those will change all the time, but I have something down on paper that I can look at if I'm having a bad day. I can look at if, you know, I need some motivation. And there's something there, they're right next to my bed. I can always see them. And all I have to do is pick up a sheet of paper and know what I have to do to get there.
Okay, so very concrete activity, even at his level of performance, where, you know, sometimes we have to go back to those goals. Why am I doing what I'm doing? Why am I trying so hard? Why do I feel maybe so defeated that I'm not getting where I want to get to? Let's revisit those goals. Let's look at the decisions we've made so that we can move forward. A couple of other things that we need to look at as health educators with our audience is just the basic self-management skill. How do we do what we need to do? If we are thinking that one of the ways that we can help our community be healthier by being more knowledgeable about what to do in emergencies, what is it that I need to know? What are the steps of CPR? What do I need to put in my first aid kit, and how do I use that? How do I brush my teeth so that I have better oral health, which actually impacts our heart health as well as our social health? What do I need to do to prevent the spread of disease in my family or in my classroom or at my workplace? What are the steps in hand washing? That's that self-management skill. And I'm sure that many of us have gotten to a point where some of these are just so routine, we do each step without thinking about it. But remember, when you're trying to encourage an audience, a community, to engage in a healthier behavior, sometimes we have to go step by step in exactly what we need to do. And then the next piece is, once we get our community to engage in a healthier behavior, to self-manage those skills, we go the next step, and that's really advocating for health, going out and getting others to engage in health behaviors. And I think that's where we as health educators can start that ripple effect. You know, we are working on that knowledge and those skills ourselves. We get to the point where we want to advocate for others, to others. So we share this with an audience, a group, your family, your friends, a classroom, a church group, a community group. You're at that level of advocacy then. We want our learners to learn the knowledge, become confident and comfortable in those skills, so they self-manage their own behaviors, and then they take that next step to advocate to others. So building healthier communities is really about starting with self, sharing with others, encouraging them to get to that point where they have become a health literate individual and sharing the message with others. And I think that's what I hope you'll see through this one unit course, just some things that you can do in encouraging your community to be healthy. So I want to go back to that first question. And for those of you who are with me this morning, I want you to think about and possibly either call in a response or email in the answer to our first question. And how do we encourage our communities, or how do we encourage an audience to engage in a healthier behavior? Have you thought about that a little bit more? Is there something you might want to share with the group this morning? And what are you going to do? How do you encourage that community to adopt healthy behaviors? All right, I'm going to just wait a minute because I see Sydney is already with us this morning. Good morning, Sydney. Thanks for joining us. All right, in high school, I had a goal to play a few minutes in a game. Worked like crazy in practice. Coach had favorites, so I knew not to get down on myself too hard. Great example of setting that goal and really keeping a focus on self, because there are some influences that are beyond us, that external influence, that you may not actually get to the point of playing a few minutes in each game. But I appreciate you are sharing that you have that goal, you worked toward that goal. At some point, you may have had to modify that goal. You know, maybe to expand, showing your coach that you had been working hard, engaging in that activity beyond the set games. Maybe you did a little bit more in practice. There are ways that you have to do that, and having that experience, Sydney, will certainly help as you work with others. To say, you know, sometimes we might set goals for ourselves that we work very hard toward, but we may not be able to get there because of something beyond our control, that external influence. So what are we going to do in addition to? So thank you for sharing that one. I think that's a real connection that a lot of us have with goal setting. All right, do we have any other comments? Okay, no calls. All right. We're going to go on then a little bit to the next part. Now that we all have a sense of what health educators are and what they do, and really what the discipline of health education involves, content and skill development and motivation, we can go on to look at audiences. Carla has popped up on the screen. Good morning, Carla. Carla's sharing her thoughts about small public events might be motivating to a community to adopt some healthy behaviors, like health fairs in a local park. Great idea. I think you're taking some consideration in how do you access your audience, and then what can you do to actually motivate them. So it's something that's engaging, something that's fun, something that's visual, easy to get to. And I think you can even think beyond the local parks. If your audience is your church group, you know, having an event at your church. If you are in a social club, having something there. Even if your audience is at the family level, what kinds of things could you bring into family events where you're engaging and encouraging? Lots of discussions around tables may be that event that motivates others. I'm going to wait for Sonia's comment. I think there are strengths in numbers. People don't seem to want to change because it might seem too scary. But once you start to get a group, there's that interest. And I think you're right. I think we're willing to try some new things. If we have a buddy, come with us. How many times have we started to look at our food consumption or our physical activity? And we get a partner to help us. You know, we get a group to go out walking together. Certainly there is that numbers. One, it's a little bit more fun. Two, there's a little bit more accountability in that as well. So I think that's another thing. So we can certainly do health education one-on-one. And for some topics, maybe that's the venue you want to consider. But there are some things that we can do small group, and there are some things that you might even do community messaging at a much larger scale. And you see a lot of that in advertising. Okay, so let's look at our audience a little bit. How do we define it, and what do we need to consider? So this is the part where I really want you to think about your particular project for this class. You're going to develop some type of health promotion, what I call a teaching learning event, or a lesson plan if you're in a classroom. We have to know where we're going to do that. So you might already be thinking about an issue or a topic that's relevant, but I want you first to think about your audience. Who do you want to share a health promotion message with? So for purposes of this class, and this is a practice for you for going out and doing more in your community throughout your lifetime, is I want you to define your audience. Are you working with a family member or a family group? Is it someone at church or someone in a social club? Is it someone on a team that you play? A neighborhood? If you're one of the teacher candidates, is it a class you want to do a project with? You first have to identify who your audience is and what size your audience will be. After that, we need to consider demographics. And, you know, if you think about all of the work that is done behind any advertising campaign, those are some of the principles we're going to draw upon. I want you to think about demographics. First, you have to consider age. The message that you develop will be very different if you're working with a preschool classroom than if you are working with the senior ladies group at your local church, or if you're working with a group of peers on a team. So you have to consider age as one of your first variables, because you're going to have to design your message, your activity, your teaching learning event to meet the needs of that age group. Secondly, you're going to need to consider gender. How you frame a message to men, boys, will be maybe, not will be, but maybe a little bit different than framing a message to girls or women. It may depend on the message itself and how you frame that. An example I can think of off the top of my head is the promotion messages we hear about encouraging women to get their mammograms, early detection for breast cancer. We're seeing messages aimed specifically at women. Go get your mammogram. Talk to your doctor about getting a mammogram. The importance of, staying on top of that. As we talk to men about, while men don't get mammograms, and most men don't think about breast cancer in themselves, think about how breast cancer would affect the women in your lives that you love. Encourage them to get a mammogram. You know, the picture up on the screen behind me, someone encouraging physical activity, doing some strength training. That message may be geared particularly toward women around bone development and the prevention of osteopenia, osteoporosis. So consider gender in when you develop your message. There are some messages that may not be a consideration that you would frame your message differently. You may have a mixed group, a mixed gender group, and you can have one message that is appropriate for all. You also want to remember cultural background. What are the cultural experiences of your audience members? Again, whether that's single or group. I want you to think about culture beyond race and ethnicity. I think that's what we tend to think of is, I'm working with Latinos, so I need to remember this. I'm working with African Americans, I need to think about this. I'm working with Southeast Asians. But remember, even within race and ethnicity, there are a broad range of cultural values, cultural norms that you have to consider. So be open to thinking about culture in the very broadest sense, because cultural influences play on an individual's attitudes and their social norms. And we know from learning theory, you need to address that if you're going to move on. I grew up in a home that was heavily influenced by Southern style cooking and the provision of meat on the table as an indicator of a good meal, a healthy meal. And so certainly as I look at my own eating behaviors now, those are still messages I hear in my head, and I have to adapt some of those messages to engage in more healthy eating behaviors now. You also need to consider language when you're planning your teaching learning event. Are we at a comparable language level? Do I need to adapt? Do I need to think about translation? Do I need to think about word choice? Am I working with individuals who are learning my language and may need some clarification of some key terms? Always something you want to consider. And then the other thing in demographics is the literacy level. If you are considering doing something where you're going to provide a pamphlet, you want to post a flyer, you need to consider, will people be able to read what you post? And really looking at the words that you put on the page. So those are some things I want you to consider. Sonia is on email with us this morning and asking, maybe it's a little bit more specific to my references for the development of your lesson plan or project. And thank you, Sonia, for the question. Certainly, for the purposes of this class, there are three assignments you will be doing. The first is due on Friday, and it has to do with identifying your audience and considering these factors. The second assignment is about using print material and how, identifying a piece of print material and looking at how it could be used with your potential audience. And then third is developing the lesson plan or project. So for the purposes of this class, you are developing a lesson plan. You're developing the components and then the final lesson plan. I hope that you take it beyond the theoretical, beyond just assignments for the class, and you actually do it. One of my objectives for you is that you leave this class feeling like you can encourage others to adopt healthy behaviors, and that in doing so, you get your community to kind of get that snowball rolling and to really become a healthier community in however you define that community. So I hope that helps, Sonia, your question, and it probably is a question from several of you in the class. So I want you to do this for class, but I also want you to do this beyond, if that is in fact your own personal goal. Okay, so we've talked a little bit about the demographics. I also want you to consider attitudes when you are defining your audience. What are their attitudes about adopting this healthy behavior? If you are encouraging your audience to eat more fruits and vegetables, a very great example, what do they think about that? Oh, fruits and vegetables, they're so expensive. They don't taste good. They take too long to prepare. You have to identify those attitudes because you're going to have to address them. If you're encouraging, as the screen behind me, more physical activity, what is your audience's attitude about that? If you've identified only running as a physical activity to promote health, if you're dealing with a group of individuals who don't feel comfortable and competent in running, that attitude is going to come up right away and say, you know what? If that's the only thing I can do, I can't be physically active. So you want to know your audience well enough to kind of anticipate some of the attitudes around that, so that your message can be more accepted, more motivating to them. The other thing that you'll need to consider with your audience is their prior knowledge. What do they already know about the message that you want to relay? Most folks, in the health quiz that I gave you all earlier, they know some of the behaviors they need to engage in to be healthy. There are times, however, that they may have misinformation. So if we can figure out, ascertain their prior knowledge, we can clarify some of the misperceptions or the misinformation that they have. Many individuals may have the attitude or the experiences, someone else telling them, you need to eat fresh produce. Only fresh food is healthy for you. With that prior knowledge, they may not be open immediately to hearing your message that we can do frozen, we can do canned, we can do a variety of preparation of fruits and vegetables that are as nutritious as fresh. We may be able to make some produce that may not be as palatable a little bit more palatable, mixing it with other foods, adding some seasonings. We may think of some foods that we eat as being unhealthy. Oh my gosh, bananas have so many carbs. What can I do? That's the only fruit I like. Well, let's think about some other options. So consider prior knowledge as you define your audience. So again, when you think about your audience, how do you define it and what do you need to consider? So if any of you are out there and you're kind of thinking about, oh, maybe I'd like to do something with my preschool class, or I've got, I teach a group of 9 and 10 year olds after school. Maybe I'd like to do something with them. Or, you know, I'm here on a team and I think I see this as a health concern, and I think maybe I want to do something with my teammates. If you're out there and you're kind of starting to think about that, starting to gel, what are some of the considerations you are thinking about? I'd certainly like you to share those with me so I can share them with the others. You know, we're not in a classroom where we have these discussions, so I hope you'll be having that discussion either by email or phone, because that's how we're all going to learn maybe a little bit more through this class. Okay, so while maybe some of you are starting to put some of those pieces together, defining your audience, let's also go on, and I'll stop at any time I get a call or a comment, about defining then how you structure your message to that particular audience. So there are really three things you need to consider as you start to think about your audience. One is, what is the content of your message? What functional knowledge, know, those core concepts, do you want them to know? I want them to know about the benefits of drinking water. Okay, that's some content. I want them to think about ways that they can set goals to drink more water every day. Okay, so you've got some content, you've got some skills in there. So you think about your content. The next thing you have to think about is your word choice. What words are you, as a health educator or a health promoter, going to use to get them to hear that concept, to hear about the skill of goal setting? And your word choice is very much going to depend on your audience. You're going to choose words differently if you're preparing that same message for preschoolers as you do for a group of middle-aged adults. So again, think about who's sitting around your table or in the chairs in front of you or on the couch next to you, and what content would you deliver, but also what words will you use to deliver it, and how do you pick those words? And then the third consideration here is tone. How do you say those words? You know, you've chosen specific words, but in what manner are those words presented? Are they presented with some authority? Are they presented in a social setting, maybe a little bit more humor? Are they presented as a teacher, a friend, a brother, a sister? All of that tone is going to come out. And you have to consider your audience when you consider that tone. When I go in to speak to a group of preschoolers, I have a different vocal tone than when I go in to speak with high schoolers or I go in to speak with a parent group. I use my audience to define how I present that message. And that's what I want you to consider, because if you are going to move into building a healthy community, those are things you're going to want to consider with every health message that you use in whatever role you play. I know that several of you are pre-physical therapy majors. Well, you're going to be doing a lot of very technical work around physical therapy with your clients, but lots of opportunities are going to present themselves for other types of messaging around healthy behaviors. Everything from physical activity to healthy eating behaviors to decision making about life events. So this is good for all of us to consider. And then lastly, I want you to consider the location of where you would present your message. Are you developing a presentation that's going to be posted on YouTube and shared with your friends? Are you in a classroom? Are you around the kitchen table? Are you having one-on-one conversations? Or are you actually having a meeting where you're using audio visuals and you're using examples and you're engaging your audience? You need to think about your other delivery methods, you know, besides telling folks, you know, what are some of the pictures you'll use? What are some of the activities? So those are all the things you want to consider as you think about encouraging others to adopt a healthy community. What I'd like to do now is to go through a series of very short video clips. These are all different public service announcements that demonstrate messaging to different audiences. The first message is around soft drink and energy drinks, and it's geared toward middle and high school students. So if we could do that first video clip, and then we'll just go through the series of them, if you will. So here we go. Thank you. Okay. That one was geared toward middle and high school students. No words, no one telling them what to do. Word choice was very specific. It's disgusting. I wouldn't use that word with another audience. Think before you drink. So again, encouraging them to take control of their own behaviors. Let's take a look at the next video clip. This one's called The Most Important Game of All.
I'm Drew Brees, and being a dad means the world to me. And one of the most important things any parent can do is make sure their kids get active at least 60 minutes each day. Studies show that physical activity not only helps kids stay healthy, it can enhance important skills like concentration and problem solving, which can improve academic performance. This means physical activity can help your kids in the most important game of all, life.
Okay, that's not a message to kids, is it? That's a message to parents, not adults in general, but to parents. That emotional connection, it helps your kids in the most important game of all, life. It showed the academic piece. So again, a very easy message to give to anybody, but very specific to the audience. Let's look at the next one. For those of you who are working with preschoolers, you're going to appreciate Elmo talking about the flu.
It's time to practice staying healthy on Sesame Street.
Yes, and the first thing you have to do to stay healthy is always wash your hands.
Come on, wash your hands with Elmo. Wash, wash, wash.
Next, try to avoid touching your eyes, nose, and mouth.
Elmo's not touching.
And when you have to sneeze or cough, do it into the bend of your arm.
Sneeze into your arm with Elmo.
Yeah, great job.
Okay, lots of demonstration in that one. We're talking about eyes, nose, mouth, pointing so that the visual cues are there as well as words, and sneezing into your elbow rather than on your hands. And of course, the whole use of Elmo, that's obviously geared toward our preschoolers. Okay, let's look at another flu public service announcement. This one's on swine flu, so a little bit older, but I think you'll get the message.
They say that they can't contain it. It's a different strain and they named it swine flu or the H1N1. Like the flu with the same old symptoms. Get vaccinated. No joke, man. What you scared of? A little poke, man?
Vaccine provides the best protection from the H1N1 or swine flu virus. Get vaccinated.
Okay. Different audience. Different word choice. Even the music. Certainly plays to that audience. Okay, and we're going to do one more on flu. Let's figure out who this audience is for.
I'm Dr. Crusetti, Commissioner of the Albany County Health Department. Now is the time to protect yourself by getting a flu vaccine, which is the single most effective way to prevent illness from the flu. Getting a flu shot will not cause the flu. The Centers for Disease Control and Prevention recommends a flu vaccine for everyone 6 months of age and older. We have a link on our webpage that will show you where flu vaccines are being offered in Albany County. The Health Department also provides flu vaccine and accepts most insurance plans. For anyone who is uninsured and unable to pay the $25 fee for a flu shot, the Health Department will use a sliding fee scale. Appointments are available Monday through Friday from 9 to 4. Please feel free to contact us for an appointment or for more information at 518-447-4589. We encourage all Albany County residents to get vaccinated this and every flu season. Thank you.
Okay, very different demeanor, very official. You saw him allaying the fears that many, particularly older individuals, have about getting a flu shot. It doesn't give you the flu. It doesn't make you sick. Very much a connection to Albany. Not only the symbols, but he's encouraging all residents of Albany to do that. He did offer a website, but you notice there's also a phone for those who might not have access to that. And of course, making the appointments. So you see that the flu message in three different public service announcements is very different. And then we'll show one more, and that's all my public service announcements for some examples. Here's one for the kids.
I smoke when I'm watch some cartoons.
I have my first cigar of the day when I get up.
We smoke in the car on the way to school.
I smoke while I'm coloring.
I smoke during my nap.
When you smoke around your kids,
I'm down to about a pack a day.
It's like they're smoking. Secondhand smoke can hurt their lung growth and permanently damage lung functions.
I tried quitting. I need to try again.
Secondhand smoke.
Okay, that's a real emotional-based one. Okay, so you've seen some examples. These are just examples of public service announcements I can share with you. You can design your own activity however you want. Remember to keep it very concrete, very simple. You're not going to decrease teen pregnancy in a large population in your community. You can't talk about every subject under growth and development. So I know several of you are sending in, you know, some of your ideas, and define it, make it very tangible, make it very doable for the purposes of this particular activity. Certainly giving your audience incentives, whether it's a little giveaway or a gift card, is another great idea. And certainly you want to get to the point where you develop this, and in your plan, think about, well, how do I know if my folks got it? Can they tell me back some of the information? Can they express some intent to actually engage in that healthy behavior I'm promoting? So as you get ideas, email them to me. I'll be happy to work with you as we kind of define them down to something workable, something concrete, something tangible. I don't want you to feel too overwhelmed with all of this. So next week we will again meet here, and we are going to continue our conversation on encouraging others to adopt healthy behaviors and really improving your community. So I do hope that you're doing your readings, that you're thinking about your projects. Your first assignment is due the 31st. Of January, so that's this Friday night. So at least you're going to work on this throughout the semester. So I hope you have a wonderful week. Here is wishing you health, peace, and happiness. Have a good one. We will see you next week.